And so go back to the Beatitudes in your Bible if you're on to, and look at that. We're going to catch back up. It's Matthew chapter 5, and I'd happen to not have written it down. 5 and verse 9 is what we're going to be talking about to begin with. But there's actually a couple of parts to this, and then we're going to, believe it or not, we're going to get through all the Beatitudes, and we'll be able to do that. Now, I'm going to go back and remind you, because it's been a little while, but I'm going to go back and remind you that every one of the first few of them was talking about us coming to the Lord. We had to be poor in spirit. In other words, we had to be empty of ourselves. We had to be mourning over our sin. And you see, it all applied to turning our lives over to Christ, coming to the end of ourselves and saying, I got nothing, Lord. I've got nothing. And we have to come to that point. Now, some of us have experienced that better than others, but the truth is that, mark this down, the ones we're talking about today are going to be, last time we talked about it, it ended on touching on the fact that our Christian lives, we are hungering and thirsting after righteousness. You see, it starts applying to us. So we come down to this one, lesson, and we come to the basically two ideas. And they seem incongruous at first, and that is peace and persecution. When you study the scriptures there and read them, and I'm not going to go back and read all the Beatitudes, I'll let you go back and read through them all again. I decided not to do that. But I wanted to talk about these last two, peace and persecution. How is it that we can have peace through persecution? And that's basically what he's saying. The Christian is going to grow and hunger and thirst and grow into the point to where he can say amen to God when his life is full of peace. And when persecution comes in, he's still going to be able to say, I love you, Lord. I know you're in this. You are in control. I am not. And you can trust him through this. And so that's where we're at. So I wanted to read Ephesians 2, 14 through 17 with you. And I picked the NLT. And it says, for Christ himself has brought peace to us. He united Jews and Gentiles into one people when, in his own body on the cross, he broke down the wall of hostility that separated us. He did this by ending the system of the law with its commandments and regulations. He made peace between Jews and Gentiles by creating in himself one new people from the two groups, together as one body. Christ reconciled both groups to God by means of his death on the cross. And our hostility toward each other was put to death. He brought this good news of peace, the gospel of peace, to you Gentiles who were far away from him, and peace to the Jews who were near. Heavenly Father, we thank you as we come to you and praise you for your word today. We praise that you would deliver it to our hearts through a supernatural, divine act of the Holy Spirit. You would open our hearts to the message of the word today, and that people would hear your word and not my words. That you people would hear your what you have laid on their heart personally, as well as what we're saying to the whole group. In Jesus' name, amen. So we have this promise of peace, and in Paul's day, of course, we're talking about Jews and Gentiles. We're talking about those who thought they had an inroad with God, and those who were outcasts, who were Noah. And guess which ones we were? We were the outcasts, okay? We were the ones who were seen by the Jews as absolutely unable to come to Christ, or to come to God in any manner. Even through Christ, later on, when you study the book of Galatians, when you study the book of Ephesians, Colossians, you see that there was still that feeling that we Gentiles were of a lesser order, that we were second class, I don't have any other way to describe it, that we just couldn't come up to their level. But Paul wrote in Romans that we were here, he says in Ephesians, he says that we were two groups that God reconciled and put back together by what we studied in the death, burial, and resurrection the last 3 weeks that we've studied. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ was to show us that we had the fact of being able to be ushered into that same family of God. That we Gentiles, in a sense, were grafted into the root of God. God's root through the power of the Holy Spirit. You and I, when we come to know Jesus as our Savior and we trust Him as our Savior, then we become not a nobody, but we become a somebody because we have been grafted into that rootstock. Now, I've had, and I know you probably have too, had several plants that you have bought that had real, real pretty flowers on it, and you get a good hard freeze and it kills it below the graft, and when it comes back up, you got a whole different plant. You got a whole different, we had one rose in Colorado that was purple, wasn't it, when we first got it? It was a real pretty lavender purple rose, beautiful flowers, except it got killed back kind of low. And then we had two colors. That same rose bush put out a real pretty old red rose and that kind of a lavender colored rose, and they came up together. And I thought, well, that's a blessing of God from the freeze to knock it into both. Well, that's kind of the way that we are in with God, is that we have been grafted into the rootstock of God, and the Jews can no longer say they are the only ones that are going to heaven, and the Gentile has to recognize that this is of God, that we have been placed in there of God. Now, when it's interesting that we talk about this in the sense that I wanted you to see that was in their day. They were struggling in peace with each other. And that's what I wanted to say. In your world, you don't have to put yourself in a position. Who is it that you have trouble with peace in your life that kind of disturbs your peace, okay? Well, it's just this, just mark it down. God came to heal those wounds. He came to tear down that hostility, that wall of hostility that has come up. It's not of God. Okay, mark it down. If it is hostility towards someone else that you feel, you are in error. God wants you to be at peace. And sometimes the only way to do peace is like my preacher was preaching on YouTube this morning, that I got to listen to him from back when I was a young man, and actually in his church is where I was able to be ordained into the gospel ministry. He was preaching on the only way to have that peace is to forgive. Not to be forgiven, necessarily. We have already been forgiven by the only one that matters, Jesus Christ. But not only be forgiven by Jesus, but then we are to turn to those who have done us wrong and forgive them. And then we can be, this peace can come. You know, think about peace. It's a wonderful thought. It's absolutely the pie in the sky to many people. That's the ultimate thing. It's worldwide peace, you know. And I have to say this. Peace isn't, you know, it to have the only peace in our lives, but to actually look not only at the peace in my life, but the peace of the whole world, that's evangelism, folks. It's that desire for us to not just want peace in our world, but peace for everyone all over the world. There's only one that can bring that peace, and that's Jesus Christ. So we are called in the Beatitudes here. Look at Matthew 5:9. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the sons of God. The peacemakers. The peacemaker means that you have not only experienced peace in your own life, but now we have turned the corner and we want peace for others in our lives. Others that we don't even know. Others all over the world. We want them to experience that peace. And so we, you know, it's the same peace in our hearts that we want in theirs. So bringing the same peace into one's heart, God's peace, to others around us should be the heart's desire of every Christian. We want to see others at peace. We want to see them able to realize that when they pass away, when they die, that they're going to be in the arms of Jesus. They're going to be in heaven immediately. We want them to have that peace. Because if you have that, the opposite of that, and you don't care if someone goes to heaven, you know, it's a really sad thing in your life. You do realize that there's going to be all kinds in heaven. There's not going to be just Baptists or just Assembly. There's going to be all kinds. There's going to be people that probably never did darken the door of a church, but turned to Jesus Christ and cried out and said, "Father, forgive me. I know I've sinned," and trust in Jesus Christ, and they're going to be in heaven. You know, it reminds me of that old joke. You know, of a guy that dies and goes to heaven. You've heard it, I know. But the guy dies and goes to heaven, and he's walking down this great big avenue of beautiful, beautiful trees and beautiful. And this angel that decides he's going to go with him and tell him about everything. So they're walking down this street, and there's all these houses of worship along both sides. And man, I mean, the first one he comes to, they are rocking and rolling. They are enjoying their worship. And, you know, he says, well, those are the Assembly people. They enjoy worship. They enjoy taking, you know, worshiping God. And he comes and goes on by that one, and he comes to a little bit more solemn, and everything's done just in order. And he says, now those are the Methodist folks. They worship God with a method of doing things, and that's their place. And he goes down a little bit further, and he comes to another one, and there's nothing happening. They're just sitting in the pews. And all of a sudden, one of them says, "I have something." And they stand up and talk. He said, "That's the Quaker folks." He said, "They sit quietly before the Lord until the Lord moves them, and then they bring it to everybody else." And he's walking down through there, and he comes to this door, and it's shut. And he says, "Shh." Tiptoes past the door. He says, "What was that all about?" He said, "Oh, they're the Baptists." He said, "They think they're the only ones here." And so, you know, the thing is we got to understand we're going to want peace for everyone, no matter who they are. That's evangelism. That's when we're not putting a name over the door of the church. Not a name that you have to be Baptist to come here, or you have to be Assembly to come here. I want a church that doesn't look at denomination, one that looks at Jesus Christ and the blood of Jesus Christ, and we follow that. Amen, Bill? That's the way it's supposed to be. Okay, so let's look at this word shalom, peace, okay? The word shalom, and you may have heard it from me before. Don't worry, just pretend you haven't heard it, and I'll get through it eventually. Okay, so the word peace, shalom, in Scripture, and this comes from a word picture. You do understand that every letter of the Hebrew has a story, a symbol, and a sound. And they learn these when they're in school. You put them together, you put this word picture together, and you have the word, and the word has another story, it has another picture, it has another sound, okay? The word shalom, when you put it all together, according to Mark Biltz, when you come to it, this is an excerpt from the book Four Blood Moons, by the way, by Mark Biltz. If you look at the word shalom, it is the Hebrew word for true peace. Okay? And he writes in here, when you put the pictures together, it means this. True peace comes only when you destroy the authority that is connected to your chaos. I have news for you. In studying that, I've got more to read on out of his book. But let me just say this. It is totally impossible for you to destroy the chaos in your world. You can do everything you can. There's only one thing you can do that really brings true peace into your heart. And that is you pick up the chaos that you have and you deliver it to the one who can destroy the chaos maker. Can I put a name to him? His name is Satan. Okay? He is going to be destroyed by Jesus Christ. Your job is not to try to defeat him. Your job is going to be to deliver it to him. So let me go on now. Biblical peace, this is still out of his book. Biblical peace comes not from pacifism, not just trying to act peaceful, but from destroying those things that are bringing chaos into the world. When Satan's authority is destroyed, true peace will finally reign on the earth. So I found that to be very, very important for me to understand. Peace only comes when that which causes chaos is destroyed. And it's speaking of that which brings chaos into your life as if it was an entity, a person. And we know that Satan has come to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Well, that sounds to me like the one that's bringing chaos into our world. We know that God is not a God of confusion because God says that he is a God of absolute order. In the scriptures, 1 Corinthians chapter 14. So when we see that God is not the God of chaos, and Satan is promoting chaos in our lives, and it's easy to see when you're going through something, don't look at the person who you feel has brought chaos into your lives. Look at the entity behind him or her. Look at Satan and bring the situation to Jesus and hand it to him and let him straighten the other person out. It takes it out of your hands. Do you see that? You know, you could be hating somebody for not doing things your own way or causing chaos in your world, and actually you're missing the point. You should be hating the one who brings that into your life, and that's Satan. But you can't do anything to deal with a divine being. But you can bring it to Jesus, and he will. So when we talk about peace, we are talking about just relying on the one who brings peace. And I just read it to you all over the scriptures. He is the one who brings peace that is beyond our understanding. He is the one that gives us peace. Philippians 4:7 says, "And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus." There's where it is. He says in John 14:27. Okay, I didn't give you time to go there. I'm sorry. Those of you that are turning, it's up here, but I like hearing the rustle of pages. And sometimes I get going too fast, and I don't get to hear the rustle of pages. I don't have my hearing aids in because I sent them off to be fixed. I couldn't hear the rustling of the pages if it was there. So there we go. Okay, John 14:27. "Peace I leave you. My peace I give you. Not as the world gives do I give you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid." You see, we have the formula for peace in your life is right there in front of you. It is Jesus Christ. So John 20:21 in the ACSB says, "Jesus said unto them, peace to you. As the Father sent me, I also send you." By the way, peace to you, and he's sending you. And did I tie that to the fact of evangelism to begin with? You see what the thing is? Jesus is saying, I bring to you the destruction of the one who brings chaos in your life, and I'm asking you to go and share that with everybody. I'm going to tell you something. You cannot bring peace to people and gossip about them at the same time. Got quiet, didn't it? You see, you say, but I don't gossip. No, you just share things. I understand the term share. Okay. Here's the deal. We are to bring peace not only to our own lives through Jesus Christ, but to others. Speak peace. Speak love. Speak words over people that will bring them a sense of love and peace and understanding. And you will be one of the greatest witnesses that there is in Jesus' name. simply because you're not doing it for you, you're doing it for them. What if you bring peace to them and they reject it? My Bible says, Jesus said to them, shake the dust off your feet and go on to the next one. Don't worry. In other words, don't let it bother you. Don't let it worry you. If someone won't receive the peace and the love that you give, or they want it on their terms, there's nothing you can do about that. You're not. So, look at this. Peace is not something that you dredge up from your own being. Rather, it's realizing that Christ alone can bring peace to you and to the others around you. You understand? You can't build peace up, dredge it up into your own life and bring yourself true peace. It doesn't happen. But what you can do is turn to the one who brings peace and trust him as your Savior and trust him to be in control. Okay. It's easy to hear about Jesus bringing you peace. But you do realize, don't you, that peace is something you cannot have peace in your life until you allow Jesus Christ to be in control over your life. He is sovereign. In the words of C.S. Lewis, he is not a tame lion. He's not going to always do it your way. He's going to do it the way God is going to do it. And you have to be at peace with that by just following him. So when you're all confused and chaos up in your life and you don't have peace anymore, and you think, that guy did it, you're wrong. It's not that guy. But Satan sure does giggle whenever you blame it on him. This is not his fault. Okay? You got the point? So we have to be able to bring peace up into our lives. Now, that other word that I used was persecution. And it's funny that these two are together at the end of the Beatitudes. He wants you to be a peacemaker, but then he turns around and says, but you will be persecuted. All right, so what do we do with that? Well, Matthew chapter 5, verse 10 and 11 says, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. That's a key right there. For righteousness' sake. Not because of it, because you're a jerk. It's not because you're not being persecuted for being a jerk to somebody. You're being persecuted when you are bringing the love and understanding and mercy of God to them and they don't receive it. Okay? So he says, blessed are you whenever you're in that position of righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when others get this, revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. If you come in the name of the Lord and you try to make a healing come about in a relationship and that other person rejects it, guess what? He said, you're blessed. They're going to hate you. Why? Because they hated Jesus Christ. You say, well, what do we do with that? Well, just mark it down. Some are going to like you. Usually they're Christians or else leaning that direction. And some are going to hate you. And you can't do a thing about it. When they come and they hate you because you're just sharing Jesus, don't let it bother you. Water off a duck's back. For goodness sake, there's nothing you can do about it. So when you come to this and you see scripture, which is Jesus talking directly to us, we have to realize that some things are going to bring persecution into your lives. Becky and I sat down and listened to, Becky, do you remember who, it was off of the Book of Martyrs, but what? I can't remember the title of it, but it was two guys that had been thrown into prison in Russia, I'm going to guess.
Two different locations.
One was China and one was like Russia. And they had been thrown in and beaten daily for months. And they had suffered persecution just simply because they were bringing Jesus Christ to that area. If you look at things like Fox's Book of Martyrs, if you read books that are from the Voice of the Martyrs, if you look at all of these and start to see, you're going to see we in America live in a very calm nation toward Christ compared to theirs. When you worship the Lord in a foreign country, you may very well pay for it with your freedom and your life. And they are out there. And I do encourage you to get the Voice of the Martyrs magazine and then pray for these people, because they're going through incredible things all over the world. I've told you before, a lot of people in a lot of countries, especially in China, their preachers cannot pastor a church until they have spent at least 2 years in prison, martyred for their faith. Some of them never get out. I've looked read books for all over where it is a normal thing for you to have to spend time in prison if you're going to be a Christian. A lot of American Christians would never make it, because a lot of them would just hit the door. I don't need that. Listen, it is not me speaking, it's Jesus speaking, who says that you will, if you're going to follow him, you will suffer persecution. Diako, and that's the way it's said, Diako, is a word in Greek that means to be mistreated or to suffer persecution. You know who the first, and it's really interesting here. You know who the first martyr was? Stephen. You know what was his position in the church? A deacon. It's the same word. Diako is the word for deacon. It means to be persecuted or to be punished for your faith. It means to suffer persecution for your faith. It's interesting we chose that word for that position of servanthood in the church. And what it's coming down to, and what I'm bringing that out for, is as we look at Stephen, he was willing to do anything, including being stoned to death, if he could just preach. I remember the story of many of the old preachers that have died for their faith. And the one I remember, and I'm not going to use a name because I think I know which one it is, but I get them confused, so forgive me. But on the pile of wood that they had stacked to burn him at the stake alive for preaching the gospel, he was hated so badly. This sounds amazing, but it is. But whenever they lit the fire, he preached the account of his burning at the stake. He preached until he had no tongue to preach with anymore. God allowed him to preach the word to those people, and they were a captive audience. Because what are they going to do? They're turning loose? I mean, you know. They hated him so bad for it that they took him down, his dead body down, and they buried it. And later, they dug him back up and burned him again and ground his ashes all up and scattered them everywhere because they hated him so badly. They couldn't just do it once, they had to do it again. How badly are you hated for your faith? How bad are you hated? The kingdom of heaven, now you got to kind of listen to this, because even Becky and I struggled with the way I read this. The kingdom of heaven is within us, okay? It is Jesus Christ, the kingdom of heaven. But when we accept Christ, it is in us. While you carry it around in your life, you are actually choosing to carry peace. And in doing so, you are carrying a piece of heaven with you, inside of you, as you walk in obedience to Christ. So if you imagine that you are a vessel to hold the peace of God, that's what the word peacemaker means. And if it takes persecution to the point of your death, so be it. You've got the idea of what a Christian should be. A Christian should be so sold out that nothing would change that. And the minute they started beating on you, that is the minute you'll find the peace to go ahead and give the gospel. One of these men that we were listening to the other night, and I'm ending on this, but one of them that we were listening to said that he finally got to the point to where the guy that was chosen to beat him every day would come in and would sit down and would just stare at him and say, I don't know why, but I love you. I don't know what to do with you, but I love you. You know I've got to beat you because that's what they've given me to do. And he would pray, the man that was getting ready to get his beating would pray for him and pray for him to receive Christ. And I don't know that he ever knew that, whether he did or not. But the man every time got to where he almost couldn't carry out his duties because of the love of Christ coming back toward him as he was going through it. Now that, folks, is what it's talking about. Whenever you look in the scriptures and you see this and you read this and you put this in your mind, it is when we get to this point that we understand that we are to be witnesses to him. Philippians 1:29, for you have been given not only the privilege of trusting in Christ, but also the privilege of suffering for him. It's a privilege. So when they mock you or they make fun of you, just receive it. Receive it in Jesus' name. You say, but I don't like being persecuted. I don't like being mocked. Okay, well, that's what you don't like. This isn't about you. This is about Jesus Christ and proclaiming Jesus to those around you. 2 Timothy 3:12, indeed, all who desire to live a godly life in Christ will be persecuted. Oh, well, I'm bringing a fun message today, ain't I? Sorry, I'm not here to entertain. I'm here to bring you God's word, and this is what it says. We are going to be witnesses, willing, if necessary, to be martyrs even for Christ. And we have to cross that border in our lives and quit playing church and start being Christians. Matthew 28:18, and Jesus came and said to them, all authority is given me in heaven and earth. Go ye. Mark 16:15. And he said, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel for the whole creation, to the whole creation. If you don't have that desire to preach the word of God to everyone, anyone, all of them, the boy that brings your groceries to the car, the waitress, if it doesn't just absorb your thoughts, does this person know Christ? I tell you what it's like for me is whenever I go on an ambulance scene and we come upon this person who is deceased in an accident, the first thing that hits my mind without fail, and I can't seem to stop it, is he in heaven or hell? You say that would torture you. No, it doesn't. It's just the fact that that's what you have to be. Every person you meet day by day, you need to be able to see past what they're like personally and say, are they on their way to heaven or hell? And give them heaven. Give them the message of Jesus Christ and what we sung about a while ago. The power of the blood of Jesus Christ is beyond all things. You shall receive, Acts 1:8, you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, right around where you live. In Judea, a little bit further out. In Samaria, the people you don't like and couldn't stand, and you didn't care whether they heard it or not. And to the uttermost parts of the earth. By the way, that uttermost parts of the earth, that these people were us. Over here. I'm glad they brought the gospel to the uttermost parts of the earth. So what is God's reward for it all? Finish now. We will receive heaven's, the kingdom of heaven. That's what he said God's reward for us would be. Well, isn't that what we want after all? Isn't that the end result? Can't you just see? My old mentor, he had an asthma condition that if he had an asthma attack, it killed him every time. And he lived in a metropolitan area, and so he would have one of these asthma attacks, and they'd put him on the helicopter, and they'd fly him flight for life to the next place, and he And he finally got to the point where he reached up, and after the last time he reached up and grabbed that paramedic by the shirt collar and jerked him down face to face, he said, if you ever do that again and bring me back, I'm going to kill you and take you with me. Like I said, he was a rough old guy. But that his point was he'd been to the walls of the city several times looking in, and then he had to go back because some paramedic brought him back. And he was angry. Okay? But the point that I'm trying to make is we need to have a vision of heaven that is so clear. That we would, when someone, Becky will tell you about a little lady that always told her, and she was from Kenya, Becky, and she would say, if somebody would die in the night, and everybody would run into the street saying, who got to go home? Who got to go home? You see, when we see heaven so clearly that we're ready any moment. Now listen, let me stop here. I'm done with the sermon. Just say this. If heaven is not your future home, you need to deal with that right now. And there's only one way you can have heaven as your home. You don't have to do a thing for it. All you have to do is put your faith and trust in the blood of Jesus Christ and say, here I am, God. I'm going to admit to you I'm a sinner. And boy, that's me right now. I'm a sinner. No problem, God. But I also believe that the blood of Jesus Christ will wash every sin away. And when I put my faith and trust in him, he said he would save me. And he would, at the end result of whatever my life is going to be. And by the way, folks, we don't know what our life is going to be. You don't have any guarantees of tomorrow. You don't have any guarantees that it's going to be fun tomorrow. But here's the one guarantee. You put your faith and trust in Christ, I can guarantee you heaven. And if you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, don't do it tomorrow. Do it